In the U.S., we don't have as many ancient philosophers or thinkers or statues of golden ancient heroes. We have a few poets and thinkers that suggest what it means to be an American hero, what it means to be able to be the embodiment of the values that we ascribe. This is where we end our series on Thoreau and Walden, by discussing what it means to be an American hero.
That's what it's gotta be this time. Yeah. Sun starts to set and the moon shall rise, shall rise.
In short, I am convinced, both by my faith and experience, that to maintain oneself on this earth is not a hardship, but a pastime. What he is suggesting here is that to be able to find fulfillment in this life is not work. To be able to find the things that we need to survive is not necessarily a hardship, but it's something that we can come to enjoy. If we live simply and wisely, as the pursuits of simpler nations are still in the sports of the more artificial, it is not necessary that a man should earn his living by the sweat of his brow unless he sweats easier than I do. What he's suggesting is that we can actually enjoy life with significantly less, that we can give up a lot of these things, that we can become a hero through giving stuff up, that we can find value and meaning in our existence when we go and give up the things that we thought we need, that we can go and grow a garden and gain our own food. Every morning was a cheerful invitation to make my life of equal simplicity. And I may say, with nature itself, I have been as sincere as a worshiper of the Greeks. What he's talking about is that he gave up all of these things that he thought he needed to go and enjoy the lake and the river, to bathe in the fresh water each morning, to wake up when he saw fit, because he was not owned and confined by that of others. He says he got up early and I bathed in the pond. That was a religious exercise and one of the best things which I did. That he could go and start each day fresh as a piece of the nature that he has become so disconnected from. For my part, I could easily do without the post office. I think that there are very few important communications made through it. This is an interesting point and something I think we should think about today. He suggests that we tend to spread and discuss meaningless ideas, that we tweet things of little value or merit. Rather, he sees no point in that, that our conversations and our actions should be meaningful, that we should engage in one another in a closeness relation, that we should go and connect in ways that have value rather than sending messages that don't really mean anything. To speak critically, I have never received more than one or two letters in my life. I wrote this some years ago that were worth the postage. The penny post is commonly an institution through which you seriously offer a man that penny for which his thoughts was so often safely offered in jest. What he's talking about is that we are spending money on things that don't really matter, that we are spreading ideas and thoughts and comments for the sake of doing it, rather than being able to find value in our actions. To a philosopher, all news is gossip, and they who edit and read it are old women over their tea. This is really a harsh critique. He is suggesting that we are merely gossiping rather than speaking of ideas and values that actually matter. Something that I think a lot of us feel at points, that we want to have ideas and discussions of merit and value, but we feel removed from an ability to do that because we're so busy talking about what's going on with the latest celebrity or thing that we have become unable to talk about our own existence and the values in our lives and why they matter. So wealth can buy only superficial things. Money is not required to buy one necessary of the soul. We can't buy happiness with money. Helps, but we need to be able to find our own meaning without these things, to be able to engage with what we have. However mean your life, meet it and live it. Enjoy what it is that you have. Be gracious for what is in front of us rather than seeking out something that we don't really need. Do not shun your life and call it hard names. It is not so bad, he suggests. He finds at the end of all of this that it is a life that is worth being grateful for. It looks the poorest when you are richest. The fault finder will find faults even in paradise. That even no matter how much we achieve, what we find or where we live or where we move or what we get, it might not necessarily bring us the happiness we seek. That comes from the inward quest. Love your life, poor as it is. You may perhaps have some pleasant, thrilling, glorious hours, even in a poorhouse. That even in the worst circumstances, we may find something of merit and value in our connection to one another. The setting sun is reflected from the windows of the almshouse as brightly as from a rich man's abode. The snow melts before his door as easily in the spring. Cultivate poverty like a garden herb, like sage. Do not trouble yourself much. Get new things, whether clothes or friends. Turn to the old, return to them. Things do not change, we change. Sell your clothes and keep your thoughts. What he's suggesting here is that we need to keep up what it means to connect with each other, to think and find value in life rather than finding things that don't matter, obsessing over the latest trend rather than being able to enjoy what is right in front of us. Rather than love, than money, than fame, give me truth. He suggests that we must go and find this, that we must find what is true in our lives rather than looking for the meaningless things to which we ascribe value. I want to end with a poem, or at least a poetic phrase of his, which I find to be quite powerful. The light which puts out our eyes is darkness to us. Only that day dawns to which we are awake. There is more day to dawn. The sun is but a morning star. Thanks for watching this circle. I hope to catch you in some of our other videos here on Circle Theory. Thanks for watching this week's episode on Henry David Thoreau and his great work, Walden. I hope you enjoyed. If you did, please like, comment, and subscribe. Let us know what you learned today. We'd love to discuss it with you. And like always, see you next week as we continue our series. Catch you next time.